شمع
Greetings, everyone. This is Menachem Yah coming at you where Shift happens at H2HDI, House to House Discipleship Institute. We want to thank all of you again. It's a Sabbath and we're having a good time and we're just here to bring you some more encouragement, to bring you to the place of maturity. We know there's a lot going on in the spirit. There's a lot being said from the pulpit, but are you hearing the voice of your Father? Remember, we are all children in His sight. Now, children grow up from the baby stage, the napios potion, which is a Greek term, and then you go from napios potion to technon, which is a Greek term, to weos, which is a Greek term, to pater, which is a Greek term. Why am I saying Greek? Because there's also ben, a family name, a builder of a family, ben. And there's a son in scripture called Ben. You know, one of Jacob's sons was Benjamin, son of my right hand. So here in what we're trying to unveil and reveal, remember, our title of our pursuit of Him is Salvation is Progressive. Have you come to the point of seeing in the scripture the Abrahamic covenant? Have you seen the Davidic covenant? And how about the covenant that Adam had with the Father in the garden? Do you know that there's a people being prepared right now to get back into replenishing the earth, taking dominion from the place of the garden? Remember, the enemy in the garden corrupted the plan, but the Father never got caught off guard and went, oops. And He never turned the earth over to the demonic realm, Satan. The earth and the fullness thereof belong to the Father from the beginning. So I see a decree out of Job 22, a decree that will always remain the same. If you decree a thing, you shall have it. So here we are again where Shift happens, and we're shifting tonight. We're going to bring you some more of the Salvation is Progressive from the Abrahamic Davidic covenant. You know what's interesting? If you read Matthew's, from the Bret Hadashah, meaning the new covenant, it leads you to read going back to go forward. That's why we're reformers of His true name, Yahuwah, Yod Heh Wah Heh. But you know, as we're speaking to one another, you have to know His name is Yahuwah, Father, Yahshua, Son. The Father and the Son, they're Echad. But He didn't leave us out. That's why He said, Abram, your name shall be changed to Abraham, and I shall make you a father of many nations. If we are Abraham's seed, then we are more than just a seed. We are a population of people that will cause a revolution on the earth, especially when all of us get a hold of reforming, restoring, and decreeing His name, Yahshua HaMashiach. That's why you got me here, and I'm under a divine assignment to bring you to keep hearing the word Yahshua. That's the Son's name. So let's get started. Let's turn to a powerful scripture that you'll love and I'll love. It's the last book of, or the last chapter of the book of Ruth. If you go back to the old covenant, hallelujah, a wise man brings things old and new into the scripture. So you got to go past Deuteronomy, past Joshua, Judges, and then you hit Ruth. Amen. Isn't that a good way of saying it? That's how I learned it. Joshua, you know, Judges, Ruth. So in the last page, hallelujah, and I'm going to get on you now, 440 in my King James Bible, the last verse says, and Solomon begot Boaz, And Boaz begot Obed, and Obed begot Jesse, and Jesse begot David. Now turn to 1 Samuel 16:13. 1 Samuel 16:13. Hallelujah. Let's see. 16 and a 13. 1 Samuel 16:13. Hallelujah. And it reads like this. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. All right? Ramah. But what I'm trying to point out is the anointing came upon him. Mashiach, because watch this, Mashiach was his name in the old covenant. Mashiach, the anointed one, came upon him according to the scripture. And what's interesting, it says the Spirit of Yahuwah came upon David. Upon David. See, that's why the Father, through the Ruach Kadosh in the book of Acts, said to wait for the promise of the Father. Why? Because you have to have the anointing of the Father to come upon you for you to begin to see and to receive. Oh, you got to see this. To see and to receive the mysteries, the proverbs, the secrets, the parables, and the face-to-face comes beyond the veil where you meet your Heavenly Father. And we call him Yahuwah. Some of them call him Lord, but see, if you study scripture and you hold on to context, Lord leads you to Baal. And you don't want to mix that because you honor your Father, your Heavenly Father. So let's go now through some scripture so that we can see how salvation is progressive. The Father said in Genesis 12, please turn there real quick. We got to see Genesis chapter 12 from the view of the progression of salvation. He's talking to his son, and he calls his son Abram. Now Yahuwah had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy kindred, out of thy country, from thy kindred, from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will baruch thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a baruch, or a blessing. King James. We like to use the Hebrew term for baruch, because baruch has a greater intimate relationship with your Father. He uses in that name, his name is there, but it's a hidden mystery, because once you learn the Aleph Tav, you'll see that the Father and Son were hidden even in Genesis chapter 1, the third word, Bereshit. Okay, let's read on. And I will baruch them that baruch thee, and curse him that curses thee, and in thee shall all families, what did he just say? All families of the earth, terra firma, cosmos, be baruch. So Abram departed as Yahuwah had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him, and Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their substance that they had gathered, and the souls that they had gotten in Haran, and they went forth to go into the land of Canaan, and into a land of Canaan they came. So you have to, now watch this, you have to leave the 30-fold to enter into the 60-fold. You have to leave the realm of babyhood to enter into youth, the strength, the joy of your salvation. Are you following me? That's why in scripture you'll find a hidden mystery. Watch. Prophet, priest, and king. All three of those hidden mystery terms were anointed by the Father. And the anointing of Yahuwah came up on them. It came up on Abraham. It came up on David. And it came up on David's son. I gave you a scripture. I wonder if you know. Do you know who David's son was? Oh, don't say. I heard somebody say, Absalom. Yeah, it was. But I'm not talking about that, son. I'm talking about where you and I are building a theme, are building a revelation that will produce a revolution in man's thinking. Because, you know, if we even get to the point, why are we talking about David? And I'm going to give you some scripture, and I want you to understand why we're talking about David. Did David have an attitude of a powerful warrior, an anointed prophet, an anointed priest, an anointed king? Did he take out one of the enemies that you and I are so fearful to even say his name, because you don't understand the posture that you have in Scripture? If you're Abraham's seed, Abraham already took the land. And that's why the father said to Abraham, I'm going to change your name. You're going to leave out of this country and enter into the country called Canaan. Well, spiritually speaking, Canaan became a person. Everybody that crosses the Jordan and gets out of judgment and comes into the promise. Oh my goodness. That's why you got to go through process. There's a promise, but to you and I to have the promise manifested, you got to go through process. Yeah. And then there's a period of processing that you go through to get to the performance. And so you got to believe in the promise. You cannot fail. You cannot waver. You cannot be tossed to and fro. Abram said, I am fully persuaded that he who had promised me a son, the promised land, I shall have him, and I will not waver concerning the promise that the Father gave me. Hallelujah. But listen, Abram understood something. He had to leave his father's house. He had to leave his kindred. He had to leave the things that were familiar to him and begin to walk out the walk of what? Faith. But we've been mixed up because we've been teaching pistis, the confession of our faith that has a confident person. So you got to go through three dimensions. Salvation's progressive. And watch this. In Hebrews chapter 11 verse, now faith. When is faith operating? Is it now or is it later? Is it after you grow up or is it right now? Well, you got to have faith to even grow from an adolescent, from a toddler, from a baby. The baby was born in a manger. He took on the shape of a man, but yet he was all Yah and all man. He was the Adama man. The Adama man is the man that had gone through all his. Remember, Adam, he was a man of dust. And we'll see that, and we'll give you some examples. Now, I got to take you quickly. Now we're going forward. Abraham becomes a father of many nations. He's looking for a city whose builder and maker is Yah, a city that had 12 gates. But before that, he begins to think about the things that the father said while he is caught up looking into the heavens. And the father says to him, Abram, I'm looking up. Abram, you shall have many sons like the stars of the sky, the things that are above, the luminaries. These are sons of light, sons of understanding. And light and understanding comes when you're at your lowest form of your training. You're going through your process. You got to go through it if you want to be fully matured, where the fullness of the Yahed bodily is in you and comes up on you. Now, let me read a couple principles. The Davidic covenant, 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 1. Don't turn there. I'm giving you the verses. Josh may give them to you on the lower thirds, but 2 Samuel chapter 7. Okay, the whole thing, you can read it. 1 Chronicles 17. Okay, now let me read you a brief part of the outline. The David's desire to build a house for Yahuwah furnished the revelation through the prophet Nathan that Yahuwah would indeed build David a house. Now watch this, John 14. Turn there real quick. John chapter 14 in the New Covenant. Hallelujah. We got to go to John chapter 14. And you already know because you guys read your Bible. John 14, 6. Yeshua said unto him, unto whom? Who's he speaking to? If you remember the whole key, he's speaking to Nicodemus. He's speaking to one that came at night. And then Yeshua says to Nicodemus, but aren't you a rabbi? Don't you teach these things? And he said, I don't even know. This is totally new to me. What do you mean you need to be born again? Okay, and that's, we'll get to that, but I want you to see, because this is where Abraham and the Abraham covenant, the Davidic covenant comes into play. Abraham was given the land. David was given the throne. Now, if you could see the progress in that, then you'll go back to the book of Ruth, where you see Obed. Now watch this, Obed had David. But you don't see David in the new covenant only when men that spoke, oh my God, if you can hear this, only men that spoke Hebrew understood David was not just a king, he was a priest and a prophet. That's why they called him prophet, priest, and king, because the Father's presence came up on him and he was able to see the progression of his own salvation. That's why David in the new covenant entered into the temple and he ate where the ark was. He ate of the showbread. The Pharisees and Sadducees were angry and they basically were saying of Moses, why did David and his people walk in and eat? They didn't wash their hands. The Father wasn't looking for a natural fleshly, come on now, entrance to the showbread. He was looking for a man or a woman or family that would believe by faith and move into that dimension. And if he was a hungered, he would eat of the showbread. And as he ate of the showbread, what he ate, he became. If you can see it, you can be it. Now, David himself, oh, you got to hear me. You got to hear me. I'm going to read slowly. Okay. Nathan, that Yahuwah would indeed build David a house. And we went to John 14 and 6. Yeshua said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man comes unto me but through, if ye have known me, you should have known my Father also. And from henceforth you know him, and I have seen him. Philip said unto him, Yahuwah, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Yeshua said to him, have I been so long time with you, and yet you have not known me? Philip, he that has seen me has seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he does the work. Believe, verse 11, believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Now, if you, oh my goodness, if you receive the words that we are saying and speaking here from house to house on this Sabbath day, this is the day that he has made. I'm going to make it personal. This is the day that he has made. Touch yourself. Now say, I am the day that he has made. Why can I say that? Why can you repeat what I just said? Because you're decreeing and declaring something the Father wanted out of Abraham. Abraham was known in the scripture that he would command his children. Abraham taught his children the Torah in the morning, in the noontime, and in the evening. While they were walking, while they were sitting and drinking from the fresh, cool waters of the river. Come on, the Euphrates River that flowed through the land of Canaan, the promised land. The river is in you, and now it flows up out of you as it's flowing up out of me right now. It's taking a toll on your mind because it's getting rid of all the stuff that you picked up from the world, from the first Adam who had become dust, because that's what Adam was, dust. But the last Adam, if you read 1 Corinthians 15, don't turn there. It started 47 and on. It talks about the first Adam was earthly dust, the man of dust, but the last Adam was a quickening spirit. Can you think with me? That's why John 14 spoke about, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it was not so, he wouldn't have not said it. That's why the book of John speaks that way. Then Yeshua says to Nicodemus in the opening chapters, He says, Nicodemus, come, now be still, and know that I am Yah. Listen, in my Father's house are many mansions. The house the Father's building was the same house that he told David, David, I never told you to build me a house. I'm building you a house. I want to abide in you. I want to come and inhabit you. Inhabit. That's why we need to preach about habitation and not visitation. When someone comes to my home, they visit, we eat, we drink, we have fun, we sing, we worship, we break open the word, and then they leave. And there's a void in the spirit because they left. But when the Father comes and it wants to inhabit you and you open up your heart to receive him, not just him, but the host of the angelic, the luminaries, those that have light, they will see you and bear witness of you that you have light, life, and love. You can operate in love yet, though we preach all kind of love. Paul preached love out of 1 Corinthians 13, but see, Paul already knew when he said, I don't know if I was in the first, second, or third heaven, but the things that I've heard, I'm not able to tell you right now. But he spoke about love. Why? Because he couldn't reveal to you that there was a process of salvation that was progressive. You've got to start from the 30-fold, the 60-fold, and the 100-fold. And I know some of you Pentecostal evangelicals, today you're already refuting what I'm saying, but it's still the truth. You don't read the scripture. You only read the new covenant because you were taught to believe that you're new covenant saints and that's it. The old covenant passed away with the law. Well, if that was true, then why would Yeshua say, if you love me, keep my commandments, pick up your cross and follow me? Why would he say that if all the prophets enumerated all the way from Adam all the way to Malachi and said, this is him that will come, there'll be a prophet among you that'll be greater than John? Well, he was talking about Yeshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. Yeshua HaMashiach. Now let me give you more principles from the outline. Hallelujah. Key principle, other Old Testament scriptures to consider when studying the David covenant, Davidic covenant, are 1 Kings 2 and 4, 1 Chronicles 22, 8 and 10, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, hallelujah, 17 through 18, Psalms 89, Psalms 132, Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1 through 10, Jeremiah 23, 5 through 6, Amos chapter 9, 11 and 12, and Zechariah chapter 3, 8 and 9. Now you know and you've heard Zechariah chapter 3, 8 and 9. So you got to read that again and go back over and realize who you are in him. Now listen to me closely. Before you can move into the manifestation of the Son, watch this closely. If you and I right now go to the Matthew's chapter 17, Matthew's chapter 17, you got to see this because this is a progressive revelation. Matthew 17, hallelujah. Why am I saying it's progressive? You'll see as soon as you get there. Let me read a little bit of the footnotes. Hallelujah. As David was anointed three times in his covenantal pursuit of Yahuwah, David was anointed prophet, priest, and king three times. Why three times? Because it had to do with the type and shadow of the outer court of the 30-fold, of the holy court of the 60-fold, and the 100-fold of the Holy of Holies, which you and I know, you've learned if you've been following us, the Kadosh Kadosh, the most holy place. Now watch. Hallelujah. Three times was he in his covenantal pursuit anointed as exalted son in the midst of his brethren, in the house of his father, 1 Samuel 16 and 13, as a king over Judah and praise. Listen to me. You got to have this revelation. Hallelujah. What did Jehoshaphat do when he was in the midst of war, when the enemy was encompassed about him, all around him, above him, and beneath him? Why? They were up in the mountain. They were down in the valley. They were behind him and surrounded him. He called on the what? Yeah, the praises, the tribe of Judah. So King David, he was anointed over Judah and praised. 2 Samuel 2 and 4. He was the head over all things. 2 Samuel 5 and 3. The principle here of the divine covenant is a sovereign disposition of Yah's, whereby he establishes an unconditional or declarative compact with man's obligated himself that he would protect us through favor and unshackle the enemy's yoke that was upon us. Do you remember David? Was David under the yoke? Yes, he was. Why wasn't he up in the front in the limelight? Because his father was trying to promote one of the other sons. But David was the last. Why? Because the apostolic ministry is always last. Paul said it like this: I believe that the Father set us apostles as the least among the other fivefold. David was the least among his other brothers. You didn't hear me there. You didn't hear me. Come on now. David was given the lowest form of ministry in his father's house. Tender of the sheep. He smelt like sheep dung. He smelt like sheep's dung. His mother had to probably take his clothes off, bathe David in the sincere milk of the word. You're following me. Come on now. And then whenever David was right after she bake the cake in the oven of fire, David had a little bread to go with that milk, and David's stature began to grow. David began to grow, and the salvation began to progress in him. Why? Because as a type and shadow, David was a kingly son, anointed in three realms: prophet, priest, and king. Yeshua HaMashiach is also prophet, priest, and king. But he also has others that we will enumerate and mention as we unfold the progression of salvation. Amen. Hallelujah. I hope you're learning something. The unconditional, a proposal of Yahuwah wherein he promises in a conditional mutual contract with man by the formula that he said, if we will, he will do this. If ye will, to grant special baruchs to man, provide he fulfills perfectly certain conditions and to execute the definition of correction in case of man's failure. In Old Testament Hebrew, the word for covenant is bereshit, and it means to cut or to divide. The pieces of the sacrifice, compact, confidentiary, league, alliance, pledge, or agreement. The Lord Yeshua HaMashiach. That's why we like to use Yahuwah instead of the Lord, because then you cut and you have mixture. Lord Baal. So now read it like that. The Baal, Yeshua, was supreme sacrifice who was cut at Calvary's cross. So now you're saying that Baal was cut. Now watch this. If Baal was cut, then he was able to distribute himself among the people. Oh my goodness, that's a hidden mystery by the enemy. That's why Baal is one of the largest terms we use today. What's another term for Baal? Lord. That's why everybody uses the term Lord. Because when the Father cut covenant, man came and put his hands to it, and he ruined the sacredness, the holiness, the kadosh of what covenant really was. When he cut Bereshit on the side of Adam, he extracted Eve. Hallelujah. And when the Father pours the seed, the sperma of his word, he always makes an incision in the side of Adam. Oh my God, you got to hear me now. He's trying to bring a progressive salvation message in three realms: outer court, holy court, holy of holies. Hallelujah. Thank you. The principle of the Davidic covenant is ultimately fulfilled in Yeshua HaMashiach. David's greatest son was Yeshua HaMashiach. My goodness, I'm fired up. Why? Because David's dad, hallelujah, Jesse, and Jesse's dad, Solomon, hallelujah, they were so in tune with the triune that they stood still and seen the salvation of Yahuwah the Father bring Abram out into the promised land, build David up out of a place of obscurity, taking care of his father's sheep, cleaning the dunghill from the sheep's dung. Can you imagine smelling like that? And then Samuel shows up and he says to Jesse, it's time to set apart a man. It's time to set apart a man. Well, family, I'm here to tell you it's time to set apart the corporate man, that the millennial man that has been called to be anointed in three realms as prophet, priest, and king. Oh, yeah, the conclusion of the whole matter, according to Ecclesiastes, is Yahshua HaMashiach is the rule, the reign, and the realm that abides in you. Hallelujah. I can give a shout. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I can just release him. Hallelujah. Because he abides in us. Hallelujah. If you're part of the Davidic Abrahamic covenant, then you don't see mixture. You see agreement, because where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of you. Victory, the Vav, the connector of Abraham to mankind, the connector of David to mankind. You get the Vav. Ah, my God, thank you, Father, for the Vav. Vav connects us to both Abraham and David, King David. Hallelujah, I thank you. Malachim.
Come on.
Malachim, the Hebrew term for David. Let me read on. The key principle, the Abrahamic covenant gave Yeshua the land, the earth. Hallelujah. He didn't give it to the enemy when Adam fell in the garden. Come on. The earth and the fullness thereof belong to Yahuwah in the garden. How did it become Jesus? There is another part of the Bereshit. The distribution of the cut pieces of the Lord. Oh my God, if you could catch this. That's spiritually speaking, that's a dark saying, but it's a true saying if you're in the light. You can see that you no longer have to call him Lord, because Lord leads you to Baal. Baal worship. And there's worship that betrays. There's will worship. Oh my goodness. You can just, I don't even want to go there. But Jehoshaphat the king, he called on the Father. David himself, hallelujah, was the head of the orchestrated symphony of heaven. He called on Judah. Praise. And I already gave you the verse in 2 Samuel 2 and 4. You take a close look at that, 2 Samuel 5 and 3. Don't go there. Read it later. Let's just stay in our topic. Hallelujah. The Davidic covenant gave him the throne. Hey, Shirabo Kosho. The Davidic covenant gave him the throne. Listen, Abraham got the land. David got the throne. Okay, I'm giving you the sustenance right here. The Davidic covenant gave him the throne, covered as a canopy throne, seat of honor, stool, authority, a thronos, thronos, thronos equals stately seat, power, a chair of the state having a footstool. Place or seat of authority, the legal right to rule the earth. Thus, the throne of David, Davidic covenant, is the legal right for you and I, and the authority to rule and to speak in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. To summarize, the Abrahamic covenant and the Davidic covenant is to have the authority to execute the apostolate from the throne to the land. The two immutable things. Ha! Come on, once in the heaven, once on earth. He spoke and he said, let it be done. And man cannot change it. Man cannot change the two immutable things. They're immutable. Father swore on the heavens, I got a son and I will promise him the land and the throne. The land and the throne. The Va in your life. You are connected to the Father and the Son, through the Va. Please understand, you've got to learn the Aleph Tav, because that will lead you to more of your covenant rights. That's why we're not seeing all this. That's why we're preaching it with no evidence. Oh my goodness, please help me, Father. We're preaching it without evidence, family.
Substance.
We gotta have some substance. That's why we're biting at the bit. Me and Josh and the rest of us here at House to House Discipleship Institute. We wanna see it come to pass, but see, it can't come to pass just through our handful. We gotta have the corporate body. That's why we're trying to be reformers of the truth and take you all the way back to the Abrahamic covenant, the Davidic covenant, and the Adamic covenant. Adam had a covenant with the Father, but the first Adam, he slipped in the act of unrighteousness. But the last Adam, the quickening spirit, come on now, he completed the task, and because of his act of redemption, he gained us all back to the Father. Let me read on. Hallelujah. The scope of the Davidic covenant, the overview scope, that which is of David, the hand of David, 1 Samuel 17 and 50. The hand. What am I talking about, the hand? Did not David destroy the Philistine giant Goliath, one that rolls in the dirt? Yeah, one that rolls in the dirt. That's what he means. That's what his name is. Yeah, and what's interesting, the Father told David to take 5 smooth stones out of the river of life. When you've been processed in the river of life, all your edges are smoothed out. We all have rough edges and we got to keep smoothing them out. But how does that work? By brothers, one to another. Come on, speaking about the fault, sharing the fault with each other. And that's the sandpaper, because according to the scripture, when you're anointed by Yahshua Mashiach, it's poured on you, it's rubbed on you, and then it's smeared on you. All that is part of the process of smoothing you out to become one of the 5-fold smooth stones that took the head of Goliath out. Now, when David executed his apostolic rite, he took that stone in his, slingshot. Okay, we have Americanized the slingshot and we made it in the shape of a vase. And then we put the rubber and the stone in as we held. But David, he put 2 strings in a leather band and he turned it and then he flung it. He had to learn how to let go of one of the strings. And it probably was a goat string made out of the stomach and rolled and then hardened in the sunshine. Put oil on it. Yeah. Some of the animal oil, as they knew, the priest knew how to do all that. They could extract oil out of a ram, out of a goat, a she-goat. Amen. So here we are. Let's keep reading. I want you to see this. The soul of David, the house, the family of David. Hallelujah. Man and the servants of David, the throne of David. All these are principles in this last day understanding. If you want to, last day understanding. You can't just go ahead and preach on the kingdom and not have the people learn that the Davidic covenant and the Abrahamic covenant. Abraham was given the land, David was given the throne. Unless you know, you just are a believer. You even say, this is what you say, we Pentecost, we speak in tongues. That's good, but in your immaturity, you're lacking maturity of the kingdom, and yet you preach the kingdom, but there's no evidence. Come on now, you could demand love and love each other and love one another, but without the evidence of teaching on the Davidic covenant, teaching on the Abrahamic covenant, you are 2/3 short of coming into fullness. Come on now, you didn't even know that David came out of Obed. 3 genealogies, come on. Obed, Jesse, David. 3 again. And then you go to Matthew. Matter of fact, let's just go to Matthew chapter 1. I want to show you that. And we're almost at the end of our timing here. Hallelujah. How much time do I have? Hallelujah. Glory. All right. The book of the generations of Yeshua HaMashiach, the son of David and the son of Abraham. Matthew chapter 1 verse 1. Why does it start like that? Because unless you are a wise man, you cannot pull the new covenant out. out with revelation unless you pull the old. Unless you see the old that is hidden in the new and the new that was hidden in the old. Those two have to merge. That's why the Vav is so important. It connects you to the new Adam. Ah, Adamah. Yeah, that's what it is. You got to study the little bit of Hebrew. I don't know. I'm not a conversational Hebrew. I just know, take a word and look at my Strong's. Take a word and look at my ancient Hebrew lexicon. Take a word and look at the Greek Septuagint. Take a word and look at my polygraph. Polyglot. Okay, I got to get into my Greek guy. Polyglot. Yeah, I'm so educated. I'm so sorry, please. I don't want to go there. But here it says, look at verse 2. And Abraham begot Isaac, and Isaac begot Jacob, and Jacob begot Judas and his brethren, and Judas begot Phares and Zerah and Tamar and Phares begot Eram, and Eram begot Abram. And then it goes on and on again. But what? Okay, let's keep going. Verse 5, and Solomon begot Boaz of Rechab, and Boaz begot Obed of Ruth, and Obed begot Jesse. And Jesse begot David the king, and David the king begot Solomon of her that had been the wife of Urias. Solomon begot Rehoboam, and Rehoboam begot Abigail. And I'm sorry if I butchered these terms, but I want to get to somewhere. You got to see the genealogy that's hidden right here. You know what they just did? They showed you it's from father to son, from father to son. And if you aren't in covenant with your sons and teaching them the scripture and the genealogy according to Matthew that you find back in Genesis, then you've missed it. Why? Because you have always searching, always learning, and never coming to the fullness thereof. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's so important. Turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Hallelujah. 2 Timothy chapter 3. You know where I'm going with this. Come on now. Verse 14. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and has been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Where have you learned them from? Josh can say to me, I've learned them from you. Where did I learn them from? For the Father that raised me up, impartation from Father to Son. And what happened to me? I had to learn the old and the new. Old covenant, new covenant. Bereshit with Bereshit. Yeah, in the beginning, in Bereshit. See, Bereshit is the term for the in the book of Genesis, the third word where the Father, Son is hidden. And then you come into the Brit Hadashah, and you start off with Matthew chapter 1 through 3, 4, 5, and you see again what I was trying to show you. David came, Abraham came through the genealogy without the Father touching Adam. The last quickening spirit, we wouldn't have a genealogy. And here, this is why it's so powerful to see the salvation is progressive. Here we are in Timothy. Okay, but continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and has been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Yeshua HaMashiach. Now, if you understand what Paul, the apostle, is speaking to a ministry son, why a ministry son? Because his Timothy's father was a Greek. His mom and grandma were believers. They were Nazarenes. They walked in the scripture. That's why it knows in the scripture, it's written of them that they had faith. And then Paul, the father in the faith, tells Timothy, the son in the faith, fear not, for thou hast not been given a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. And then he comes back and he reiterates what he's learned. Verse 16, all scripture is given by inspiration of Yah, and it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in right ruling. Verse 17, that the man of Yah may be perfect. Look at that, complete. Not perfect like without sin, because we're going to do an act of unrighteousness. But I'm talking about perfect, complete in the teaching of the old and new. Without the old, you have no new. Without the old, you have no son. No redeemer, because Adam was a type and shadow of the redeemer of mankind. He was supposed to replenish, take dominion, hallelujah, and be fruitful right in the beginning. The enemy came and he subdued him and subtly played a trip on his mind, and he ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil through the fruit that his wife ate, Eve. So why Eve? Why is her name Eve after she ate? Before that, she was still Adam, because Adam means male and female. They were both male and female. That's why you have a soul, which is called the, come on, it's the female gender. And then you have a spirit, which is called the male gender. This is why you have Sarah, spirit, and Sarai. Sarah, Sarai. That's why you got Sarah and Hagar, spirit, soul. Amen. This is why you got Esau, Jacob, spirit, soul. You have all these terminology. Well, let me change that. It's Jacob, spirit, Esau, soul. Because some of you go, oh, he said it wrong. I know I made a brief mistake because I'm excited. But I want just you to be aware that all scripture is given by inspiration of Yah. The Ruach Kadosh, which is the function of the Father, dwells in you and inspires you to take of the old and the new and bring it forth as a foundational teaching. This is why you can't demand certain things to have control. You can't beg and plead for people to come to your building. You ought to be giving them who they are in Him, and they'll show up, because now you became a place of information for revelation, not a place to house a bunch of people to sit on their duff. You got to get them up and give them a towel so they can begin to serve others. That's the mystery of waiting upon Yahuwah. And them that wait upon Yahuwah shall renew their strength, and they will fly like an eagle on eagle's wings. They will see from the highest dimension down to the earth plane. They're not sensual. James 1, and I'm done. James, hallelujah. Did we already read James? Probably not. Maybe I should just quote it to you. But in the book of James, it talks about earthly wisdom and heavenly wisdom. And it talks about essential. It's perverted. What do you mean perverted? Well, it's not. It's earthly, sensual, devilish. Three realms: outer court, holy court, holy of holies. Why is it devilish? Why is it sensual? Why is it earthly? Because the devil himself, Lucifer, Hasatan, was in the heavenlies. He, at one time, he abided in the Most High. He abided in the right ruling. He abided in the Kadosh place. Come on, when he fell and he seduced mankind. He was sensual. This is why the wisdom from beneath, earthly, is devilish, sensual, and earthly. But we have the Ruach Kadosh that takes us up on high, and we are able to see the Davidic covenant and the Abrahamic covenant working both in you and in my family. According to the board there, if you see it, Adam, mankind, Matthew 22:14. You read it when you have time. You got to read it from the Davidic Abrahamic view. You got to read it with this in mind. Then you go to the Davidic covenant, and it says, few are chosen, Matthew 20:16. How many know that all mankind is called, but not all mankind desires to go further? You come into the Davidic covenant. Then you go to the last and final, the Abrahamic, where eternity was spoken into Abraham, and he began to say, Matthew 24:13, who said that? The son of Abraham, the son of David, spoke in scripture by inspiration. We read it out of Timothy. Now I'm finishing out of James. Thank you, Father. I thank you now in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach that we have the wisdom that comes from above. We have set our minds on things above. We are seated in heavenly places. We set our affections on things above, not things beneath. We look unto the author and finisher of our emunah. We are no longer tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, but we are unmovable, hallelujah, fully persuaded that he is able to perform that which he promised unto us, that we should come forth and be complete in him, perfect like he is holy, perfect like he is holy, perfect without blemish, but with him, hallelujah, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, until we see each other again, Shabbat Shalom, may his countenance dwell on you, shine upon your face, because you have come into a face-to-face relationship with him. Hallelujah, you're no longer looking through a mirror dimly, darkly. You are seeing your daddy face to face. Allow him to work in you and become more like him. Until we see each other again, shalom, shalom, shalom. Let's not get hurt. You know what we're called to do? To bring an